So hey everyone, welcome to this video. In this session, we will be diving into the Windows Fundamentals Part 1 of Try Hacking. As you can see, I am on the room. So I have already started the machine so as to not delay the video. And let's start with the task 1, which is Introduction to Windows. So actually this room is for basics that you can dive into the Windows operating system. So you just need to learn things about which you don't know or which you have less knowledge about. So let's do that. The Windows operating system is a complex product, as you know, with many system files, utilities, settings, features, etc. Okay, so it is loaded with settings and other features also. So this module will attempt to provide a general overview of just a handful of what makes up the Windows OS, navigate the user interface, make changes to the system, etc. The content is aimed at those who wish to understand and use the Windows OS on a more comfortable level. So if you are comfortable with Windows only and you want to just learn about it, so this room is for you. Okay, but whatever you think about this room, you should complete this room. It is actually easy for anyone. And let's see other things. Launch the attached virtual machine. I have already done that. As you can see, I have been allocated the IP address also. The title is Windows Fundamental 1. I will show you the room. I will show you the system. As you can see, there is the system. So, and there is also another method to access the virtual machine, that is via the remote desktop. I won't be going into a remote desktop in this video, but if you want it, you can just comment it so I can suggest you, or I will just make a video on that. Okay, so we have already started the system, so read above and start the virtual machine. This task is completed. Let's move on to the task 2. So the task 2 talks about the Windows editions. As you already know, there have been several editions in the past, from and now also Windows 11 is coming. It's a new news. So the Windows operating system has a long history dating back to 1985, and currently it is dominant operating system in both home use and corporate networks. Because of this, Windows has always been targeted by hackers and malware writers. So actually, Windows has been targeted by hackers and malware writers because it has been used in an enormous amount. Everybody all uses that. Okay, so it has more susceptibility. Okay, so Windows XP was a popular version of Windows and had a long running. Microsoft announced Windows Vista, which was completely overhaul of the Windows operating system. There were many issues with the Windows Vista. It wasn't received well by Windows users and it quickly phased out. The same thing happened to Windows 8. It quickly phased out also. Windows 10 rolled out very soon after the Windows 8. And let's see the other. When Microsoft announced the end of life date for Windows XP, many customers panicked. Okay, corporations, hospitals, etc. also panicked and scrambled and tested the next viable Windows version, which was 7, against many other hardware and devices. Windows had to work against the clock to ensure their products worked with Windows 7 for their customers. Okay, so actually there was a condition of chaos all over. So actually you can see that this task takes us back to the history. Takes us back to the history and other things about the Windows 7 Windows editions. Okay, so Windows 7, as it was quickly released soon after the Windows Vista failure, and then it was having a end of support date also. Okay, and then Windows 8 came, and Windows 8 was also very short lived. Okay, and then arrived the Windows 10, which is the current operating system, and Windows 11 will also be arriving soon for all the PCs. And Windows 10 comes in two flavors, Home and Pro. You can read the difference between the Home and Pro here. Okay, Home and Pro are the two versions of this, two flavors of this. Even though we didn't talk about servers, the current version of Windows operating system for servers is Windows Server 2019. So the Windows Server 2019 is the current running operating system for servers. Many critics like to bash on Microsoft, but they have made long strides to improve the usability and security with each new version of Windows. So actually, Microsoft wants to make the system more user friendly. Okay, if you have heard the recent news, Microsoft has announced that the Windows 11 operating system will also support Android applications also. Okay, so if it supports Android application, it would be susceptible to Android malware also. Okay, so there is a trade-off between usability versus security. Okay, if you have to increase usability or user friendliness, you have to compromise with security in some way. Or if you have to increase the security, you have to compromise with the user friendliness. Okay, so there is a trade-off, which is a simple logic. And the next thing here we are given is the update of Microsoft that Windows 10 retirement dates are also announced, and it will be up to October 14, 2025. Okay, let's see the question. What encryption can you enable on Pro that you can't enable on Home? So before seeing any other thing, let's move on to the link which are being given in the room. So it has a comparison chart about the Windows 10 Home and Pro. So as you can see, the checks which give us the indication that the feature is included. So what are being asked is that what encryption system can you enable on Pro that you can't enable in Home. So as I can see, there is the BitLocker device encryption which is available on Pro but not on Home. So the answer with us is BitLocker. Yes, it's correct. Let's move on to the task 3. So the task 3 talks about the GUI. GUI is also known as the graphical user interface, which is used mostly in the Windows desktop for increasing the user friendliness, or I said the usability. Okay, and it is given that how you get into the login screen, then you log in the passwords and other credentials, and then you get the Active Directory or the system, particular system which you have on your machine. Okay, so the screenshot here you can see which gives the first, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth labels, and these labels are for the desktop, start menu, search box which is for Cortana, and task view, taskbar, toolbars, notification area, and other. Okay, so the desktop contains all the shortcuts to the program, folders, files, etc., which you can easily access. Okay, and these are contained in the icons. So the icons try to give you a graphical user interface. Okay, then these icons will either be well organized in folders, sorted alphabetically, or scattered randomly. Okay, there can be any organization. Okay, in either case, these items are typically placed on desktop for quick access. Okay, the look and feel of the desktop can be changed to suit your lighting by right clicking anywhere on the desktop. A context menu will appear. So let me come to the machine. So here is the machine. All this area which you can see is our desktop. Okay, this is our desktop. Okay, this is our desktop. So anywhere in this desktop, if I right click, Here we have the display settings, personalized settings, so that we can personalize all this stuff. Okay, we can change the picture background. Okay, we can set it to solid color or slideshow, or we can choose the fit about that. We can choose the colors, what colors are being given to us. Okay, we can see about the lock screen. We can also see about the themes and fonts and start menu, taskbar, all those things. Okay, let's see what other thing is there. Here you are talked about the color, as you can see, and the background. So let's move on to the start menu. So here's the start menu. As you can see, here are all the apps. Okay, on the top you will see sometimes the recently added ones, and on here you will see the favored, or you can say the most used apps. Okay, and here's the other settings, pictures, documents, administrator accounts, and the power button. Okay, the sections I have already told you. Okay, and you can see here are the recently added apps, as I said. So, and okay, so you can see that if I right click on this and just print to start, it will appear here. Okay, so so I can pin any of my favorite apps or programs to the start menu, so as to access it in less time. Okay, then let's see the taskbar. So here's the taskbar. Here are the toolbar settings, and you can either search things, or you can hide the search button. Okay, or I can just lock the taskbar also, or task manager will be accessed from here also, as you can see. If I click on the more details, here is all the processes, performance, and users which we are logged into. Okay, and the notification area is this. Here is the notification area. Here you will get the notifications. Okay, and if you see here is the network, here is the calendar timing, and here are the notifications, specific notification from the programs, and here are the hidden apps, hidden icons, you can say. Here is the audio service, and here is the action center. Okay, so the questions are that which selection will hide or disable the search box. So let us see that. Okay, for the search box, search settings, hidden. So if we click on hidden, the search box will disappear. So but if we click on show search box, it will appear. So actually the selection is hidden. Okay, we are on the right track. Which selection will hide or disable the task view button? Okay, let us see that. Task view button, show task view button. Okay, the task view won't be able to appear to us. So show task view button. Okay, show task view button. Okay, so it is correct. Besides clock, volume, network, what other icon is visible in the notification area? So here is the clock and calendar, here is the network, and here is the audio service icon, and here is the action center. So action center is shown to us. Action center. Okay, let's move on to the task four, which is file system. So the file system, the Windows use the new technology file system or simply you can say NTFS. Okay, before NTFS there was the use of FAT16 or FAT32 or FAT32 or FAT16. Okay, and there was also the use of high performance file system or HPFS. Okay, and you will still see FAT partitions in use today. If you sometimes format or see the properties of your pen drive, you will see FAT32 or FAT16. Most probably FAT32 you will see in your USB devices. Okay, but it is not more no more in the Windows computers or laptops. Okay, and NTFS is known as journaling file system. Okay, because if in case of a failure, if there is a failure in the system, the file system can automatically repair itself. Okay, the file system can automatically repair itself because it contains a log file for anything happening. Okay, so it will automatically repair itself. And NTFS also gave us the hope from other limitations. Okay, the previous versions or the FAT16 or 32 supported files larger than didn't supported files larger than 4 GB, and there were no specific permissions for folders and files, and there was no folder and file compression, and there was no encryption. Okay, but NTFS addressed all those things, and all these blue links you should actually visit those. Okay, visit and just read them so as to get a little bit more knowledge. Okay, so as you can get an edge over everything else. Okay, and if you are running Windows, what is the file system your Windows installation is using, so you can check the properties of the drive your operating system is installed on, typically on the C drive. Let's see this in our machine. So the machine here actually has properties. Okay, let's see the properties. Oh, actually I think, okay, so as you can see, it the file system is based on NTFS, and other things that it is stored on the C drive. Okay, and now let's see about other things, that the permissions for us on the NTFS volumes are full control, modify, read and execute, list folder contents, read and write. Okay, and the image you have here would be useful for you, that all the meanings is given for read, write, read and execute, list folder contents, modify, full control. Okay, so you should read that. And there are some permissions for users and groups. Okay, everyone has some restricted permissions. And let's move on to the another feature of NTFS, which is alternate data streams. So the alternate data stream is a file attribute specific to Windows NTFS. Okay, every file has at least one data stream. Okay, every file has one data stream, and ADS allows files to contain more than one stream of data. Okay, so it gives us an opportunity to have more streams of data. Natively, Windows Explorer doesn't display ADS to the user. There are third-party executables that can be used to view this data, but PowerShell gives you the ability to view ADS for files. Okay, from a security perspective, malware writers have used ADS to hide data. So ADS is actually used by malware writers to hide data, and it actually gives us the power to contain more than one stream of data. Okay, so not all is its users are malicious. So don't think that all its users are malicious, or it is only used by hackers or crackers. Okay, For example, when you download a file from internet, there are identifiers written to ADS to identify that file was downloaded from the internet. So if you try to install a file which you have downloaded from internet, then the Windows will just inform you that it has been downloaded from the internet. Let's say if the Wireshark shows us that. Oh, I think it hasn't been downloaded, it has already been installed. So let's move on from here. Okay, so there is other link which is given to us about the ADS, and you can just click on it and see about it on the Malwarebytes Labs. Okay, ADS things are given, you should check out that. All the links which are given, you should check out that. And another room for us, which is the advent of Cyber 2, you should also consider that. Okay, so the question is, what is the meaning of NTFS? So the meaning is new technology file system. So yes, it is correct. Let's move on to the task 5, the Windows system /32. Windows slash system 32 folders. Okay, so actually the Windows system 32 folder is very important for us. Okay, it is important because it contains all the files which are necessary for Windows to operate. Okay, so you should never ever try to delete or modify things in this folder. Don't you ever try to do that. Okay, don't you ever try to do that, because it is very crucial for us. And if any file is affected, you will suffer from problems. Okay, if you have done in your childhood or any age in your life, then you would understand this. I have already done that, so I understand that. So Windows folder /windows is traditionally known as the folder which contains the Windows operating system. Okay, the folder doesn't have to reside in the C drive necessarily, it can reside in any other drive and technically can reside in a different folder. Okay, so in any drive you can install it, C, D or any drive. Okay, this is where environment variables, more specifically system environment variables, come into play. Even though not discussed yet, the system environment variable for the Windows directory is %windir%. Okay, so this is the system environment variable for Windows directory. For Microsoft, as per the Microsoft, there is a definition for us that environment variables store information about the operating system environment. So all the information about the operating system environment is stored in an environment variable. Okay, so this information includes details such as operating system path, number of processor used by operating system, and the location of temporary folders. All those information will be stored in the environment variable. And there are many folders in the Windows folder. Let's see all that. So let's see that. I will just click on cross. Okay, so here we are. So actually the C drive contains many folders, and the thing which is talked here is about the Windows. So the Windows folder also contain many things. As you can see, there are so many folders, as well as there are so many other things. Let's see, one of the many folders is system 32. Here you can see system 32, we are in the system 32 folder. And here also there are so many folders, as well as there are DLL files also with us. Okay, so as I said, so that system 32 folder is very important for us, and you should never ever try to modify it or delete it. Okay. So let's see the question. What is the system variable for Windows folder? So we already know that. I will just copy paste it. So let's move on to the task 6, which is users, user accounts, profiles and permissions. So let me just show all that thing in the machine. So in the machine are the users. Okay, here we are with the current account. Okay, and with other users, as I can add somebody else also on this PC, and there will be information with me that I am the administrator, which is a local account. Okay, and there will be sign in options also, and other users are also there. Okay, so you can set it onto like this. If you just type run and lsrmgr, which stands for the local user and group management. Okay, local user and group management, and you can see here, here are the users, and before that here are the groups. Okay, here are the users and groups. Okay, so we have that, all the information about the users and the groups in this machine. Okay, so we can also add somebody else on this PC, as I showed you. And let's move on to the questions also already. What is the name of the other user account? Let's see all the accounts which we have. So here we have the try hack me Billy. Okay, so the name is try hack me Billy. So if you wonder that why I have used try hack me Billy only, because all these accounts are not functioning. As you can see, they are already down. Okay, and here you can see the account is not disabled, and all these accounts are all disabled. The account is disabled. Okay, but try hack me Billy is enabled. Okay, what groups is this user a member of? So what group is try hack me Billy a member of? Let's see that in the properties if we can find it. Yes, the member of remote desktop users and users. Okay, let me just type that, remote desktop users and users. Okay, that's correct. What built-in account is for guest access to the computer? Let us see that, which account is for the guest. As I can see, here is the guest account, and it has already written that built-in account for guest. Okay, let us see in the, yes, as you can see here it is written built-in account for guest access to computer / domain. Okay, but it is actually disabled, but no worries, we have been asked only the guest account, so we will just write guest. And what is the account status? The account is actually disabled. As I told you before, account is disabled. Yes, that's right. Let's move on to the task 7, which is user access control, user account control. So user account control actually means for having some privileges or having some rights, or you can say having some authority to do things on your computer. And nobody except the administrator has more privileges And you don't need user account control if you are already the administrator. You won't be asked about things. And let us see about the Wireshark thing, which is docked in the screenshot. I will just move on to the properties, and in the securities tab, so here you can see the group or usernames which have the access. Okay, so the system actually has most of the access except the special permissions. The administrator also has all the accesses except the special permissions, and the administrators other groups, or you can say the other group which is named as administrators, also has all the permissions except the special permissions. Okay, so it should be clear to you. And we can do that again with our run command, and just type in luser mgr.msc. so it actually stands for local user group and group management, and you can see that all the users are here. So it actually contains all the permissions for us also. As you can see, if we have any permissions here, profile, sessions, remote desktop services, remote control. So and if we can see about things that what is being talked here. So actually the user account control will sometimes want the administrator accesses. Okay, and you will see a icon like this. Here you can see that. I will just try to show it in a better manner. Here you can see the shield type account, shield type icon, which actually considers the user account access for doing anything special or just installing the programs also. It will do that. So it shows us that for doing anything or just installing this program will require user account control. Okay, it will require high privileges. So it is an indicator for us. Let's move on to the question, which is what does UAC means. We have already seen that, user account control. So let's move on to the task 8. The task 8 actually moves us through the settings. So I won't talk about the more hours in settings, but I will just show you things. Here's the settings button, and here's the control panel also. Okay, so you can use both of them. The control panel was actually the main settings area for Windows 7, but the settings section is also added through Windows 8 and 10. Okay, let's see what is being taught here. So in the control panel, change the view to small icons. What is the last setting in the control panel view? Let's open the control panel. So there's the control panel. So we should view by small icons. And the last thing which I see is the Windows Defender Firewall. So Windows Defender Firewall is the last thing. Okay, Windows Defender Firewall. So it's correct. Let's see the task 9, which is about the task manager. So I will just show you about the task manager. So here is the task manager. So the task manager actually shows us the processes, the performance of our machine, the users which are actually enabled, and the details about all the processes running and all the services running. Okay, all these processes, all these things are being shown in the task manager, and the currently running apps are shown in this section. And you can also see that there is a section of background processes. Okay, and there is a section of Windows processes. There is a section for Windows processes. Okay, so let's see what is being asked to us. And we are being said to refer to a blog post. For more detailed information, I would recommend you to visit that blog post. And let's see the question. What is the keyboard shortcut to open Task Manager? So actually I know it. It is the Control Shift and ESC, and that's the correct answer. So here we conclude the Windows Fundamentals Part 1, and I think the owners of this room will make Part 2 and 3 also. We will wait for that. But this was a good session, and I hope you liked it. If you liked it, please subscribe to my channel, and it will be a great help for me. And I will continue to bring more walkthroughs to the TryHackMe rooms as I progress on with myself also. So there is the conclusion, which is, again, this was a generic overview of the Windows OS, and there are intermediate and advanced topics for each the topic or the task that was covered in this room. Okay, and as you progress in the TryHackMe, you will know about the Active Directory, which is very important. Okay, Active Directory attacks. The file system will also have a good weightage in that. Okay, user accounts and permissions will also be very good topic. Okay, the task 8 ended with the detailed blog post explaining the task manager in great detail. So I said that you should see the blog post. And in future modules, we will cover topics like Windows folder. So I hope there will be a new room or the part 2 or part 3 about the Windows Defender, Firewall, etc. And until then, I will just say completed, and it's completed. Okay. So thank you for this, and goodbye.